Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Senior Vice President Vic Gundotra.
Well, hello, everybody. Hello. On behalf of Google, let me extend our warmest welcome to all of you. To the over 6,000 people here at the Moscone Center in San Francisco, welcome. And to our Google I.O. viewing parties that are happening all around the world, over 350 different parties with over 30,000 in attendance, welcome. And finally, let me also welcome the over 1 million people who will be watching this event live streamed on YouTube. Welcome to Google I.O. You know, this is our fifth year, and we're going to make this Google I.O. incredibly special. Our teams have worked very hard to put on something really great for you, and we still have some surprises left. At the end of the day, however, it's not just about the hard work our teams have done. This conference is really about you, developers. When you think back over the last 5 years, things like Google Chrome or Android were in their infancy. We owe, in no small measure, the success of our efforts due to your support. Thank you. Thank you for betting with Google, and thank you for supporting us. Thank you for spending 3 days of your life here at the Google I.O. conference. We hope you're going to absolutely love it. Now, one small favor to ask, please. If you have a hotspot, please turn the hotspot off, as it's going to greatly increase our chances of having a successful set of demos. Okay, with that, let's get this started. Please join me in welcoming Director of Android Product Management, Hugo Barra.
All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Android keynote at I.O. 2012. Last year on this stage, we talked about momentum, mobile, and more. Momentum, accelerating of Android across the world. Mobile, everything we're doing to innovate on smartphones and tablets. And more, extending the Android ecosystem well beyond the typical mobile device. This year, we're continuing with the same three themes and picking up right where we left off. Let's start with momentum. Last year, right here, we announced that Android had crossed the mark of 100 million devices. 100 million was a huge milestone for us back then. It's been a pretty busy year, and I'm thrilled to announce our latest milestone. Ready? 400 million Android devices. $400 million is a pretty huge number, but we're definitely not slowing down. Last year, right here, we announced that we were seeing 400,000 new Android devices activated every day. Well, today, 1 million new Android devices are activated every single day. That's about 12 new Android devices every second of every day. Thank you. More devices in the hands of more people, and a truly global phenomenon. Take a look at this chart. What you see here is a heat map representation of the growth in Android devices throughout the world over the last year. Places like Japan, South Korea, and France grew between 200 and 300% in these 12 months. But what's even more impressive is that the developing world is adopting Android at an even faster pace. Very large markets like Brazil, India, Thailand, and Indonesia all grew around 500% over the last year alone. Really, really exciting. And we're continuing to build and innovate just as fast in the Android team. Today we want to share with you what we've been working on since we launched Ice Cream Sandwich late last year. I'd like to introduce you to our newest release. You guys ready for this? Android 4.1 Jelly Bean. Jelly Bean builds upon what we created with Ice Cream Sandwich. We want things to be simple, beautiful, and really smart. There are a few things about Jelly Bean we wanted to cover today. Project Butter, a performance-focused effort that went deep into the guts of the platform. We'll then talk to you about a number of delightful improvements that we've made throughout the entire system. And finally, we'll show you the new Google search experience on Android. Thank you. To tell you about Project Butter, please welcome Android Engineering Director, Dave Burke.
Thanks, Hugo. Our brain's visual cortex is especially sensitive to the physics of motion. It notices delays of as little as 10 milliseconds. So in Jelly Bean, we put a lot of effort into making the user interface fast, fluid, and smooth. This is the project that we call Project Butter. The first thing we did was improve the system frame rate and make it consistent. We took the display refresh signal called VSync and extended it to drive the entire Android framework at 60 frames per second. That's one heartbeat about every 16 milliseconds. And now everything runs in lockstep. Application rendering, touchscreen processing, screen composition, and display refresh. In Jelly Bean, we also introduced triple buffering in the graphics pipeline. And this allows the GPU, the CPU, and display to all run in parallel without waiting on each other. The result is a more consistent rendering framework, and everything feels a lot smoother. Scrolling, paging, animations, they're all buttery smooth. Next, we focused on improving touch experience by solving two problems. The first problem is that touch events are reported independently of screen update. In Jelly Bean, we now actually anticipate where your finger will be at the time of screen refresh and use that position to draw the display. This results in a more reactive and uniform touch response. The second problem relates to how devices conserve power. They actually dial the CPU back to a lower frequency when there's not much activity in the system. And if you interact with the system in that state, it can potentially take tens of milliseconds for the CPU to ramp up and respond. And this can lead to a sluggish UI. So in Jelly Bean, we introduced the concept of touch input boost. Now when you interact with the screen, we'll instantly ramp the CPU up. It's literally putting the full power of the CPU at your fingertips. Now, one of our goals when we started to work in Jelly Bean was to be able to measure and improve interactive performance in a scientific way. So we created a new tool called SysTrace. And SysTrace collects data directly from the Linux kernel and uses that to produce an overall picture of what the system is doing. The data is represented as a group of vertically stacked time series graphs. And in this particular application example, you can see that there's a rendering interruption that's much longer than 16 milliseconds. And this results in dropped frames. When you look at the data, it's pretty easy to correlate that with the database interruption here. So you know what to fix. SysTrace comes with the Jelly Bean SDK, and it's a really useful tool for device manufacturers and for you guys to optimize the performance of your application. So how noticeable are these changes in practice? Well, we got out a high-speed camera to compare a stock device running Ice Cream Sandwich against a device running the latest Jelly Bean. Let's take a look. So this is a really sophisticated camera capable of capturing 4 million pixels at a rate of up to 300 frames per second. Device on the left is running Ice Cream Sandwich, device on the right, Jelly Bean. So let's take a look at the launcher animation. So the Jelly Bean device has a much higher frame rate. It feels a lot smoother. Let's take a look at another example. Let's look at the quick contacts animation. And again, the Jelly Bean device on the right, it animates much more smoothly and much more consistently. And it just feels much more silkily smooth. And that's the triple buffering and desync in action. So these improvements apply across the whole system, and they apply to all applications. And it's something that we're going to continue to improve on in future Android releases. If you want to learn more about this, we've got a really good session tomorrow called For Butter or Worse. and to butter you up even further, let me pass you back to Hugo. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave. Well, Jelly Bean is not only the fastest and smoothest version of Android yet, but we've also made a ton of improvements throughout. We've touched every corner of Android, and it all comes together in a way that's really delightful. So let's jump right in. I have Randall here from the Android product team to help me with demos. And first of all, people spend a lot of time on the home screen in Android, because we've always let you customize it the way you want with apps and widgets. But when you've got a lot of stuff on your home screen, adding another widget or getting things to fit just right can be a little bit difficult. So we solved that problem in Jelly Bean. Let's go to the device. So here's a home screen with a bunch of apps. Now, Randall's gonna pick up a widget from another home screen and move it to this one. Now watch what happens. Everything gets out of the way and aligns perfectly around the widget. But what if the widget is too big and there isn't enough room for it on the home screen? Well, here's another home screen that has even more apps. Watch what happens now when Randall moves that widget to this screen. It magically resizes on its own. And if you want to do some spring cleaning in Jelly Bean, you can just pick up a widget and toss it off with a familiar gesture. You can do the same thing with apps, as many as you want. And that's probably enough, Randall. Thanks. Okay, let's go back to slides. So we also made text input on Android a whole lot better. In Jelly Bean, we refined and retuned our dictionaries. They're much more accurate, more relevant, and the keyboard learns intelligently over time. We've also added a bigram prediction algorithm, which guesses the next word you're going to type before you start typing it. It's really cool stuff. But sometimes your hands aren't free to type, which is why Android supports voice typing. Now, while voice typing works really well when you have a data connection, if you don't have one, it doesn't work. And it can actually be slow if you have a bad connection. So in Jelly Bean, we shrunk the Google speech recognizer that runs in our data centers to fit on the device itself. So if you have a poor connection, or if you're offline, you can still type with your voice. Why don't we go to the device? Let's show you that live. So Randall's going to put his phone in airplane mode, and he's going to use his voice to write an email. Now, watch what happens, and do listen carefully, because this is one of the few times when we let him speak.
This is a demonstration of voice typing, period. Words appear even though I don't have a connection, period.
There you go. All right, let's go back to slides. We're launching offline voice typing initially for US English, and we're gonna add more languages pretty soon. Now, we also wanted to make sure that Android works well for everyone, particularly given how quickly Android is growing around the world, like I showed you earlier. So in Jelly Bean, if we could go back a couple of slides, please. So in Jelly Bean, we've improved support for Arabic and Hebrew. We've added a new Arabic font to the platform, and we're also adding 18 new input languages, including Persian, Hindi, and Thai. Okay, let's go to the next slide now. There you go. Making sure Android works for everyone also means improving accessibility. With Jelly Bean, we're introducing Gesture Mode, which enables blind users to reliably navigate the UI using touch and swipe gestures in combination with speech output. It's really, really awesome. Thank you. We've also added platform support for external Braille input and output devices via Bluetooth. And if you want to learn more about accessibility in Android, stop by the sandbox just outside to see some awesome Android devices with integrated Braille support. So that's accessibility. Now, let's talk about camera. In Ice Cream Sandwich, Ice Cream Sandwich made it possible to snap photos really quickly. The Jelly Bean camera app makes it possible to review photos you've already taken really, really quickly as well. Let's show that live. Let's go to the device. So Randall is snapping some photos here, and you'll notice that there's a new animation of the photo flying out to the right. So that tells you with a simple wipe, you can bring it back into view and look at the photo you just took. Thank you. From here, you can tap and share this photo, as you know, or you can keep swiping to look at the other photos you took. If you want to go through these photos really quickly, just pinch to go to film strip view, and then you can scroll much faster from here. And if you don't like a photo, you can easily get rid of it by just swiping it away. Pretty cool, right? And if you delete a photo by accident, you can always tap undo and bring it right back. So that's camera. Pretty cool. In Ice Cream Sandwich, we introduced Android Beam, which lets you share things like web pages, contacts, maps, and so on between devices using NFC by just tapping them together. Today, more than 1 million NFC-enabled Android devices are shipping every single week, and that number is growing quickly. In Jelly Bean, we're introducing two new Android Beam features. First, you can send someone a photo or video by just tapping your phones together. And second, you can instantly pair and connect your phone with an NFC-enabled Bluetooth device, like a speaker or a headset, by just tapping it with your phone. It takes 1 second. Absolutely brilliant. Let's keep going. Thank you. One of the signature features of Android is notifications. Android notifications are great. They show you what's important, they never get in your way, and they're accessible from anywhere. In Jelly Bean, notifications show you more information. They're actionable, they expand and collapse, they have full-bleed photos, they're beautiful, and they're customizable, so you guys can build amazing notifications into your apps. I really want to show you this. Let's go to the device. So here at the top, there's a missed call from Hiroshi. Rather than opening the phone app and calling him back, you can do that right from the notification itself. Just tap on callback. It's really quick and easy. Now, if you leave the phone app while you're in this call, when you're done, you can just go back to notifications and hang up straight from there. It's awesome. Now, the Gmail notification moves up and automatically expands. You no longer need to open the Gmail app at all to see what's going on in your inbox. It's all right there. Nothing important right now, so Randall, why don't we just swipe that away? Okay. Now, here's a calendar notification, and you can see that there's a meeting here at 10:30. Now, if you're running late or you can't make it to the meeting, you can easily email everyone in the meeting and let them know. Just type email guests. And because you'll usually be in a rush when you do this, we give you a set of canned responses. You can choose any of these or, of course, write your own. Thank you. Let's go back to notifications. All right, so we can see that Romain shared a photo on Google+. Now, you can actually see the full bleed photo right here in notifications. And you can plus one it or even share it right into your circles, all without opening the app. Here's a notification from Foursquare. You can quickly like or comment on a friend's check-in, again, without having to open the app. This is TuneIn Radio. It's a great Android app for listening to radio stations from around the world. When I have a song playing, I can see this beautiful album art. I can control my music, and I can actually quickly favorite a song from here without opening the app. Now, let me also show you a quick trick. Notifications expand on their own as they bubble up to the top, as you've been seeing so far. But you can also make them expand or collapse whenever you want with a simple two-finger gesture. Watch this. In the expanded Pulse News notification here, I can see news stories complete with photos and headlines. Really, really powerful stuff. So those are Jelly Bean notifications. They expand and they collapse when you need them. They're actionable, and they can show you a ton of new information. And just like an ice cream sandwich, you can dismiss all notifications at once with one simple tap. Android makes your life easier. Simple tasks should never require complex procedures. Now, let's talk about search. From the very beginning, Android had search at its core. With Jelly Bean, we took a hard look at search and redesigned it from the ground up. First, a new UI. Second, faster and more natural voice search. And third, a new feature we're calling Google Now. Let's start with the new UI. Last month, we introduced the knowledge graph in Google Search. The goal is for Google to understand that the words you use when you're searching are not just words, but real things in the real world. In Jelly Bean, we're using the power of the knowledge graph to show you search results in a new, richer way. For example, if you want to know what movies Angelina Jolie has starred in, we'll show you this card. Or if you ask how much the Earth weighs, you'll see an answer like this. If you're searching for the weather in New York, we'll show you a card with the weekly forecast. If you want to find a nearby Starbucks, we'll show you a card with a quick map of some stores close to you and a shortcut to take you to Google Maps. Now, let's show you what we've done with voice search. You know, sometimes you'd rather just speak your search query or ask a question. In Jelly Bean, voice search is much faster. It's also better at understanding natural language, and it speaks answers back to you using the power of the knowledge graph. Let's go to the device and show you this live. Randall, why don't you show us a few more examples? You can talk.
Okay, I'm gonna ask a few questions, and Google will respond. Who is the Prime Minister of Japan?
The Prime Minister of Japan is Yoshihiko Noda.
All right.
Try some more?
We'll try another one. What is the definition of robot?
Robot, a machine capable of carrying out a complex series of actions automatically.
It's pretty appropriate. Try another. How tall is the Space Needle?
Space Needle is 604 feet tall.
Okay, we'll give it one more try. Show me pictures of pygmy marmosets.
That's great. Now, notice that if you go back to the results, if you swipe away that card, there's a wealth of additional information from the web on pygmy marmosets, which, as I'm sure you know, are the smallest monkeys in the world. Google will always give you web search results for all of your questions. Thanks, Randall. Let's go back to slides. Thank you. Now, the third part of the new Android search experience is called Google Now. Today, smartphones are powerful. They can do pretty much anything you ask. Search the web, give you directions, traffic info, anything. But smartphones are only as smart as you tell them to be. They rely on you to do everything. You have to enter a search query, you have to type in a street address, and you have to ask for traffic in a particular area.
But with Google Now, that starts to change. Google Now gets you just the right information at just the right time. And all of it happens automatically. So how do we do this? If you choose to, Google Now uses things like your search history, your location history, and your calendar to figure out what information you might need and when. Let's see a few examples on slides. Traffic. Google Now figures out when you commute from home to work and back. It'll then tell you how long the commute on your usual route is going to be, and it'll give you a faster route if there's a lot of traffic. Next, public transit. When you're near a bus stop or on a platform at a subway station, Google Now tells you when the next bus or train will arrive. Places. Google Now will show you bars, restaurants, and places of interest around you as you walk down the street. And when you're in a restaurant trying to figure out what to order, Google Now will tell you what that restaurant is best known for. Next, appointment. When you have a calendar event, Google Now will help you get there on time. For example, if you normally take the bus to get around, Google Now will tell you when to leave based on how long it'll take you to walk to the bus stop, when the next bus arrives, and how long that bus ride will take. So we get there on time. Flights. If you have an upcoming flight that you've searched for, Google Now keeps you up to date on the status. It tells you which terminal to go to, and it updates you if there's a delay, all automatically. Sports. Google Now keeps you updated on your favorite sports teams in real time. You'll see scores and upcoming games. And the best part is you don't need to set up your favorite teams. You've already done that by searching for them on Google. Travel. Google Now knows when you're traveling. And if you're traveling internationally, Google Now will give you interactive cards for currency conversion and translation. It also conveniently tells you what time it is back home. And there's tons more. I'd like to welcome on stage Barış Gültekin, Google Now Product Manager. Barış is going to show you how Google Now helps him navigate his day. Barış.
Thank you, Hugo. Hi, everyone. I'm really excited to show you how Google Now can do work for me. So let's get started. The easiest way to get to Google Now, there are two ways. You can either tap on the search box, or you can simply swipe up from the bottom of the screen. And when you do that, you see the familiar Google search box. You also see a beautiful header that changes based on your time and location. You also see the Google Now cards beneath it. So let's start with the first one. Google Now is telling me that I have a meeting at 10:30 a.m. today. It's also telling me that this meeting is 16 minutes away from where I am. Google Now also notifies me when it's time to leave, so I'm not late for my meeting. Here, it tells me that I need to leave by 10:14. All right. Google Now knows that I'm a Giants fan, and right now, it's telling me that there's a Giants game coming up in a few hours. And this card is going to keep me updated with the scores, and I know what's happening in real time. If I wanted to, I can buy tickets from here real easily. All right, let's think about when you want to figure out a place to get lunch. Google Now knows that I'm not here too often, and I don't know the area too well. So it's showing me a few places nearby, including some restaurants. Let's take a look. 00 looks pretty good, so I'm going to tap on it and get more details. This takes me to Google Maps, and from here, I can get wealth of information. I can also book a table if I wanted. Cool, let's go back. And Google Now has also figured out that I go to the gym usually around lunchtime. And it's telling me that the gym is 29 minutes away. So I want to get a workout, but I was going to take a flight. And it looks like my flight is delayed. So I have enough time to actually go and squeeze in a workout. Google Now is also telling me that my flight is delayed, and I'm only 19 minutes away from the airport. It's also telling me that when I get to the airport, I'm going to go to Terminal 2. Well, that's a quick demo of what Google now can do for me today. Your carts will get smarter and more accurate as you use them. And we're just beginning. We'll be adding more carts over time. Thank you. Back to you.
Thanks, Barish. That was great. So that was an overview of Jelly Bean for you guys. Project Butter, a bunch of delightful improvements like easier home screen organization, offline voice typing, a new camera app, and awesome expandable notifications. Lastly, you got a preview of the new Google search experience on Android. Can't wait for you guys to actually try that. Now, I'm sure you all want to know when you can get your hands on Jelly Bean. We're going to roll out over-the-air updates to Galaxy Nexus, Motorola Zoom, and Nexus S, and also release Jelly Bean to open source, starting in mid-July. Thank you. But we're making the SDK available to you today as a developer preview. You can download it right now from developer.android.com, Jelly Bean SDK developer preview. The SDK is built for you guys, Android app developers. But as you know, chipset vendors and device manufacturers develop for Android too, to bring us their awesome hardware. So today we're announcing the Android Platform Development Kit, or PDK for short, which is like the SDK, but for Android hardware developers. It contains the necessary source code and low-level API documentation required to port Android to your hardware if you are a hardware developer. PDK will be available, thank you. PDK will be available to Android device partners 2 to 3 months before the platform release date of all future Android versions. Thanks. And we've actually started with this release. A beta version of the Jelly Bean PDK has already been available to a few partners for the last few weeks, and they've been providing us valuable feedback. We've incorporated that feedback, and now it's available to everyone on an ongoing basis. PDK enables Android OEMs and chipset makers to innovate in parallel with Google and ensure the latest Android release can be well optimized for their hardware. So that's what we're doing on the platform side. To tell you about what we've been doing on Google Play, here's Android Engineering Director Chris Yerga, fresh out of the salon.
Thank you, Hugo. Those hair jokes never get old. So this past March, we announced Google Play, your digital entertainment destination, not just for apps and games, but also for movies, music, and books. Google Play is entirely cloud-based, which means that all of your content is always available across all of your devices. And Google Play is Android apps, lots of apps. Today, there are more than 600,000 apps and games in Google Play. And we're seeing more than 1.5 billion installs every single month. And we've just reached a total of 20 billion app installs across Google Play. It's incredible. It's billion with a B. And there's no way we could have done that without the support of everybody in this room. Developers are the lifeblood of our ecosystem. So thanks for all your hard work and support in achieving this amazing milestone. Over the past year, we've launched a number of features to support you as developers and help you build your business. Android apps are available in 190 countries across the globe, and paid apps are available in 132 of those countries. You have flexible ways to monetize your apps. You can use an ad-supported model, paid applications, and in-app billing, which you have embraced very successfully. Just a year after the launch of in-app billing, more than 50% of our apps revenue now comes from in-app billing. And so we wanted to keep that momentum going. With the recent launch of subscription billing for applications, we now enable you even more ways to monetize your Android apps on Google Play. We're also giving users more ways to pay for your apps. We've expanded carrier billing to a dozen additional countries, carriers across 5 different countries. And we're continuing that momentum by adding new partners. We've also given you insight into your business with additional metrics in the Google Play Developer Console, easier ways to distribute your apps with APK expansion files, and ways to connect with users with the ability to reply to reviews. And for aspiring new developers out there, we've launched Android Training, a collection of free online classes to help you learn best practices. And today, we're announcing several new features for developers as part of Google Play. So first, we know that you spend a lot of time and money writing great apps. And so we're constantly at work trying to help you protect your investments. We're introducing app encryption in Jelly Bean. From Jelly Bean forward, that's fine, you can love it, come on. From Jelly Bean forward, paid apps in Google Play are encrypted with a device-specific key, both before they're delivered to the device and stored on the device. We're also announcing smart app updates. So today, when you update an app, your users have to download the entire APK again. Clearly this wastes bandwidth and battery life, and we could do better than that. With smart app updates, users will only download the parts of the APK that have changed. We looked at some of the most... I've read through this stuff so many times, I don't know like what parts are going to be exciting to you. But that, the team is very excited about this as well. And on average, across the most popular apps we looked at, a smart APK update is about a third the size of a full update. So it's going to be much easier for you to have your users on the latest version. It's a win for carriers, developers, and users. And the best news about it is we handle it automatically for you. You don't need to do anything, and it's supported on Gingerbread and above. So for a couple years now, we've offered developers a service we call Android Cloud to Device Messaging, which lets you send data to apps while they're running in the background without having to implement your own sync solution. It's been amazingly successful with the developer community. We deliver billions of C2DM messages every single day. Now we're ready to take C2DM to the next level, and we're announcing Google Cloud Messaging, which adds great new features like message multicasting, message payloads, and more. But I think the best feature, hopefully you all agree, is that Google Cloud Messaging is completely free for all developers and there are no quota limitations. If you want to learn more, we're going to have a special session on this tomorrow on Google Cloud Messaging. I would urge you to attend. So, lots of exciting developer announcements, but Google Play is also about great digital content, movies, music, and books. Google Play has thousands of movies to rent. You can watch new releases, blockbuster films, and your favorite classics on your Android phone, tablet, or even on the web. Google Play also has millions of songs from your favorite artists, whether it's an indie band, rock legend, hip-hop stars, and everyone in between. And you can also bring all the songs you already own to Google Play and store up to 20,000 of them for free in our music library, so you can listen to them anywhere as well. And finally, Google Play is also the world's largest ebook collection with more than 4 million titles available. And all of this content is stored in the cloud, so it's available whenever you want, wherever you are. And today, we're bringing more content to Google Play. It starts with movie purchasing. Now, along with rentals, your favorite movies are available for sale on Google Play, which means that they'll be yours to watch as many times as you like. And we're also adding TV to the video experience. You'll be able to purchase episodes or entire seasons of your favorite TV shows. It's perfect for when you have a spare half hour or you're on the bus or something, and it really works well with a mobile device. All of this is launching today on Google Play, and we've partnered with some of the biggest names in the entertainment industry, including Disney, ABC Studios, NBC Universal, Sony Pictures, and Paramount. Finally, magazines are coming to Google Play. We've partnered with top magazine publishers, including Hearst, Condé Nast, and Meredith, so you can enjoy hundreds of titles right from your Android phone or tablet. This includes premium magazines like Esquire, Wired, and Family Circle. Buy single issues or subscription. And we offer 14-day free trials on our most popular magazines to encourage you to try it out. We've got all this great content on Google Play. Music, movies, books, and now TV and magazines as well. You can enjoy it anywhere, on your phone, on the web, or on your tablet. And speaking of tablets, I think Hugo has a few words to share.
Thanks, Chris.
Well, it's always been a goal of the Nexus program to provide you with the best of Google experience, access to the latest software coupled with an Android experience the way that Google envisions it. We wanted to take that model one step further. We wanted to design a best of Google experience that is optimized around all this great content available in Google Play. We wanted a device that lets you immerse yourself in all of that media. We wanted you to be delighted when you read books, magazines, watch movies, and play games. So we partnered with a great company, Asus, to help us build just that device. And today, we're introducing Nexus 7. It's a beautiful 7-inch tablet. It's built for Google Play. It's running Android 4.1 Jelly Bean. And here it is. Nexus 7. And by the way, we're really pleased to have Johnny Shi, the chairman of Asus, here in the audience today. Johnny, please stand up. Thank you. So let me tell you a bit about Nexus 7. It's super thin, light, and portable, and yet we've managed to pack a lot into this device. First of all, the display. 1280 by 800 HD display, which is perfect for reading and watching videos in stunning clarity. Performance. Tegra 3 chipset with a quad-core CPU and... Wait, there's more. So Tegra 3 chipset with a quad-core CPU and a 12-core GPU. That's basically 16 cores, which makes everything, including games, extremely fast and smooth. Front-facing camera, perfect for Google Plus Hangouts and video chatting. All the connectivity options you'd expect, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and NFC. Gyroscope and accelerometer, essential for high-performance gaming. And battery, up to 9 hours of video playback, and up to 300 hours standby time. And best of all, it's only 340 grams, just about the weight of an average paper book. It fits perfectly in one hand. You can put it in a purse or bag. It doesn't tip over when you're reading or watching a movie in bed. It just feels right. That's Nexus 7. Music. Music, movies, books, magazines, apps, and games. All the great content from Google Play right at your fingertips. Now, to show you Nexus 7 in action, here's Chris Yerga once again.
Thanks, Hugo. We designed the Nexus 7 experience with three goals in mind. Create the best possible Google Play experience, make all your favorite Google apps work beautifully, and support the next generation of apps and games. Nexus 7 is made for Google Play. When you power it on, your content is front and center. Right here on the home screen is my library, containing the content I've recently been reading, listening to, or watching on any of my devices. So earlier, I was reading The Born Dominion on my phone. So we can tap on the cover there and pick up exactly where I left off on that other device. Nexus 7 is an ideal device for reading books. The form factor and the weight are just right. It has the portability of a paperback backed by a cloud-powered personal library of books. Now I'd like to show you the magazine experience on Nexus 7. Here's the new Google Play Magazines app. And just like your coffee table, the newest stuff is on top. You can swipe through and find something that's interesting to read. Why don't we go ahead and Esquire. And once I bring it up, I can tap on it and bring up a list of page thumbnails on the bottom to kind of quickly swipe through, find an article that I'm interested in reading. So yeah, that one looks good. And once we open it up, you look at the content, it just looks beautiful on Nexus 7. But if I want to focus maybe on something that's a little bit more of a pure reading experience, I can tap on the view text link and get the contents of the article in a form that's optimized for that. Still looks beautiful on Google's web. From here, I can also navigate and bring up a table of contents and quickly pull up any other article. So now let's look at some interactive features. So why don't we go to Shape Magazine. And here from the cover, since this is an interactive title, I can tap on any of the interesting articles there and get to, I think he wants to work on his abs, so he's going to pick the flat abs. So we've gone beyond print replica here and added interactive elements to custom fit the text to the device, keeping everything readable without impacting the design. Randall can drag up to expand the content right here on the page and even tap on the link to jump into an exercise routine and get further details on those all-important ab exercises that Randall likes to do, all without leaving the page. So that's our premium magazine reading experience on Google Play. Nexus 7 is also ideal for watching movies and TV wherever you are. Long plane rides, road trips with the family, or just sitting at home watching on the sofa. So let's open the Google Play Movies and TV app. And here you see all of your movies. We can swipe over to see TV shows, and you can get to your personal videos as well. So why don't we pick something? Astute observers will note that I'm a Parks and Recreation fan. So why don't we tap on episode one there and start watching some TV.
Who are the suits? They want me to run for office. Oh my God, Leslie, yay!
I know, right? Yay!
Wait, what does that mean about you and Ben?
I don't know, I think it's gonna be really bad.
Uh-oh. Do you wanna go back to saying yay?
Yes, please.
Yay!
Video looks stunning on Nexus 7. You can see the individual hairs on Ron Swanson's mustache. So in here, you have access to the movies and episodes you purchased and links to the store for other episodes of the season. And you can, of course, also download your TV shows for offline use if you're going to be somewhere without Wi-Fi, like on a plane. So that's finding content I already have. What about discovering new content? With Nexus 7, we're introducing a powerful new recommendations engine for discovering content that's relevant to you. We present this information on beautiful and dynamic widgets on your home screen. Here you can see that we've set ours up for recommendations for apps, books, and movies, but you can customize it to show the content you're most interested in. And if you don't like a particular recommendation, just dismiss it and you'll get another. These widgets are intelligent, and they'll get smarter and more accurate the more you use them. Now, sometimes new content finds you. Maybe you hear a song you like on the radio or TV, but you don't exactly know what it is. We've added a What's This Song widget. You just tap on it, and it will identify the music playing and give you a link to the Play Store so you can buy it instantly. So the device is beautiful, but let's go back to the slides for a second. Nexus 7 is the perfect device to use all the Google applications you already know and love. Gmail on Nexus 7, it's a perfect size to read and respond to your emails. Chrome, your favorite websites look beautiful on the HD display. And this is the first device that ships with Chrome as the standard browser. Let's go back to the device and take a look at some of those apps. Why don't we start with YouTube? So the new YouTube app has a great tablet-optimized design. You got your channel feed here on the left, and you can just swipe over. Why don't we pick something here to watch and get some video going? You've got high-def YouTube right in the palm of your hand. It's the YouTube that you already know and love, but optimized for Nexus 7. Now, in addition to exploring a huge amount of videos online, you can also explore the world around you. So let's take a look at Google Maps. Now, in Google Maps, you can find your way around with the features you are already familiar with, like turn-by-turn navigation, public transit, live traffic, and street view. But what about getting to know a place before you get there? I heard about a local bar called District, so let's go check it out. We can tap here and get all this great information about the restaurant, including Zagat reviews from Google Plus Local. And I can also scroll down and tap on See Inside. Once I do, I'm inside the bar, I've got this nice view, and for an even better experience, I can turn on compass mode. So why don't you go ahead and do that, Randall? Now, we've had this feature for a little while, but what we've done in the latest version is hook it up to the gyroscope, which makes it incredibly smooth and fast and very responsive. It's just like being there. Now, as we announced, we're also adding support for offline maps, so you can save the data for an entire city locally on the device and be able to use maps without a data connection. Simply tap on the menu. It's as easy as bringing up the menu and tapping Make Available Offline, and you're good to go. So those features are all in the latest version of Google Maps, shipping with Nexus 7. Now I want to talk to you about Google Currents. Currents brings you all the great content that the web has to offer in a mobile magazine format that looks incredible on Nexus 7. My morning routine is I open up Currents first thing in the morning every day to check out the news. Subscribe to a number of feeds. You have trending stories here around the top. But why don't we tap into the Daily Beast and take a look at what articles are there. So here we have a list of recent articles we can swipe through and read in a reading mode that's actually built on the same technology that the magazine's web view is, so it has that same beautiful look. And you can see the content here is pulled straight from the web and beautifully formatted for Nexus 7. Now, behind all of this great content is the power of Google. So what we've done is we baked Google Translate right into Currents. So we can go to the menu, and I can translate everything into another language. And within a few seconds of doing that, Randall, I believe, picked Arabic. So we're going to see this entire edition translated into Arabic. Currents is another Google app that works great on Nexus 7. With its quad-core CPU, gyroscope, and accelerometer, Nexus 7 is a serious gaming device. We'll start with the game Horn from Phosphor Games in Chicago. Horn is an epic adventure set in a richly detailed world with the kind of environment never before seen on a mobile device. You've got lens flares, environmental effects, and even individually rendered leaves on the trees. So as Randall takes the express elevator down here, we can see that in addition to the graphics looking beautiful, the animation is very fluid and it just controls beautifully. This is the kind of experience that until recently, you would have not have been able to see anywhere out of a dedicated gaming console. So Horn is really putting all those 12 GPU cores to work, but of course not everything in Horn is shiny and beautiful. Let's cut there. We don't want to ruin the surprise, but it ends badly. So, going from alive to dead, we're going to take a look at Dead Trigger from Madfinger Games. They're a developer located in Prague. Now, while for some games, all right, got my Prague over here, nice, guns and zombies would be enough of a selling point. But Dead Trigger uses the computational power of the Nexus 7 to create everything from, you see these water droplets that are refracting and sort of going down here on the lens. You got realistic fogs, and of course, lots and lots of blood. All right. And he was supposed to do a headshot there, and he did it. Give it up for Randall. Nice job. Who says mobile gaming has to be casual? So now that you've seen everything Nexus 7 can do, Hugo, I think we all have one remaining question, which is, how can I get one?
Thanks, Chris. That was awesome. So Nexus 7, built to bring you the best of Google in a super thin, light, and portable device that's optimized for Google Play. It's a fantastic device that we want to get into the hands of as many people as we can.
That's why starting today, we're making Nexus 7 available, starting at only $199. And when you buy your Nexus 7, we'll also give you a $25 credit to spend in the Google Play Store, as well as some great content to build out your library. You'll get the Transformers Dark of the Moon movie from our friends at Paramount Pictures, the book, The Born Dominion, and free magazine issues of Popular Science, Food Network, Condé Nast Traveler, and others. Starting today, you can order Nexus 7 directly from Google Play with orders shipping in mid-July. It's available in the US, Canada, the UK, and Australia, with more countries to follow. Now, Android was always meant to go beyond phones and tablets. Last year at I/O, we showed you a sneak peek of a new kind of Android media device, which we called Project Tungsten. We've been really busy since then, and now we want to show you what we've created. And to do that, please welcome Joe Britt and Matt Hershenson.
All right. Thank you, Hugo. You just saw an amazing tablet for enjoying all your great Google Play content, but we want to go further. We're entering a new era in consumer electronics where the combination of hardware, software, and the cloud is opening up an entirely new world of possibilities. With Project Tungsten, we brought together the power of Android and Google Play to develop the first consumer electronics product Google has ever designed and built from the ground up. We call it Nexus Q. Let's take a look.
I think most people have no idea what it is when they first look at it.
We're trying to create something that is unexpected,
powerful, and mysterious.
There was a point in time where consumer electronics were a physical thing, a transistor radio or a cassette player, a Walkman. And then the software element of it became very important in terms of the experience. And now I think we're entering this era where consumer electronics is the hardware and the software and the cloud.
Q is a small Android-powered computer, and it connects to all of the media that you have stored in the cloud. The fact that it was going to be in your home meant that it needed to be not only functional, but also beautiful.
Google products are used by millions and millions of people every day on the web and mobile side. How that translates into physical products, it raises a lot of interesting opportunities.
This is how you get the software from the device to your phone.
Now that we're moving into an era where devices are controlled from your phone or your tablet, we can allow people to use their devices to control their entertainment in a very simple way.
People's stereo systems, they were very much revered, but when you go around to people's houses, you would never touch them. The idea here is that people can be inquisitive, play with it, but also start using it interactively.
And it's the sort of thing that you think, why can't everything do this? Isn't this the right way that music should be?
This really is a third wave of consumer electronics, and it's all about the cloud. Nexus Q is just the beginning. Thank you. We're really excited to unveil Nexus Q. It's a small Android-powered computer that's designed to live in your home. It plugs into the best speakers and TV in your house, and it's always connected to the cloud. Nexus Q tightly integrates with Google Play, so you can easily stream music and video. You use your Android phone or tablet to control it, but you're not actually streaming content from your device to it. Instead, Nexus Q pulls your content directly from Google Play. So, in other words, you use your phone or tablet to control the cloud. Now, before I show you how this works, Matt's going to tell you about all the design and engineering that went into creating Nexus Q.
Thanks, Joe. When we started developing this product, we wanted to build something really special, not just another black box. The industrial design is totally unique, and what we've managed to put into this small sphere is nothing short of incredible. The heart of Nexus Q is an OMAP 4460, which is the same chip used in Galaxy Nexus. It also is a state-of-the-art audiophile-grade amplifier built right in, so you can hook your speakers right up. And at 25 watts, this small sphere can really fill a room with beautiful, clear, crisp sound. Of course, music and video today are digital. Some would say analog outputs are a little old-fashioned. Nexus Q has optical digital audio and micro HDMI outputs, so you can stream music and 1080p video to the best speakers and the best TV in your home. Nexus Q has dual-band Wi-Fi and Ethernet, as well as NFC and Bluetooth, which lets you set it up in a few minutes right from your phone. There's also a micro USB port to connect future accessories and encourage general hackability. Always popular and always a great feature. The hardware is pretty cool, but what brings Nexus Q to life is Android. Joe's going to show us what it can do.
Okay, let's take a look at Nexus Q in action. So Matt made me move my living room to the stage here today. And I'm going to start by playing some music for you. So up here, let's go to the device. And we can see that this is Randall's device, and he's gone into the Google Play Music app. Here we can see his entire music collection. We can see his playlists. As he scrolls around, we can also see his artists, albums, and so on, all stored in the cloud. Now, Randall is going to choose a room to start playing music in, and he's picking the living room. Let's see what music he picks. And it looks like he picked The Need Superficial by Odyssey. You have very good taste, Randall. And it's very appropriate because building Q has been a bit of an odyssey. Sounds really good. And as you can hear, it starts playing right away from the cloud. Now, we wanted the experience of listening to music to be more than just great quality sound. Part of what makes Nexus Q so cool is that listening to music can also be visual and interactive. It lights up with a ring of LEDs around the perimeter, which respond to the music as it plays. And if you have it hooked up to a TV, you'll see this visualizer as well. If you have more than one Nexus Q, you can play music throughout your entire house. You just pick the rooms you want, and it'll play your music in sync. Now, for example, Randall's going to show us how this works. He's going to pick he's going to add the green room Nexus Q, so the rest of the team back there can enjoy the music in perfect sync with the living room here on stage. You know, mobile devices have made music more of a personal and sometimes isolating experience, but music is often best enjoyed with friends. That's why we made Nexus Q the first ever social streaming device. It's a cloud-connected jukebox where everyone brings their own music to the party. Your friends can just start adding songs from their own Google Play music libraries to Nexus Q. Let me show you how this works. I'm going to ask Matt and my friend Chris to help me out. Where did Chris go? Oh, here comes Chris. Chris, please come on over and have a seat on the sofa. So
far away.
Now Randall is going to start playing another song from his Nexus 7. And once he does that, we can see the music cue. And Randall picked the same song. So we've already heard this song. So let's give somebody else a chance to play the DJ. Matt, what would you like to hear?
Well, how about this song, All the Lights, by Fawn? Reminds me of those cool lights on Nexus Q.
Nice. And so Matt is going to use his device to add a song to the queue. And what we should see is that song added to the queue. And there it is. Look. So how about another one, Matt?
Okay. Pretty cool. I'm going to do some more. How about this song, Dark Star, by Pulisia?
It's a really cool song. So you can see that the songs Matt just added appeared right in the queue on Randall's device. So everybody who has a device is able to see the queue of music that's going to be played. Chris, what do you have to add?
I think I'm going to add this really great new rockabilly guitarist, JD McPherson, but I'm not interested in waiting around, so I think I'm just going to take right over.
So this is a great example. So at any time, anyone can move songs around the queue, and anyone can take control of the listening experience. Everyone can see the queue in real time on their devices. It's pretty cool that my friends can now play their music in my living room. So that's music on Nexus Q, with multi-room playback and social streaming. A great amplifier built right in, with digital outputs so you can hear music on the best speakers and TV in your home. And speaking of TV, wouldn't it be cool if you could bring all of your movies to a friend's house? Well, with Google Play, you're always carrying your entire digital library with you. And as a social streaming device, Nexus Q lets anyone connect and start playing videos from their phone right away. Have you guys seen any movies lately?
What do you guys think about Transformers: Dark of the Moon?
I hear it's pretty good, but I always think, is there more than meets the eye?
The robots in disguise.
Do we have that movie?
I have it in my library right here.
Okay, cool. Let's check it out. So Matt's going into Play Movies and TV app on his Nexus 7, and all he has to do is choose the living room TV and hit play.
I was watching it at home last night. I'm going to start it up here, and it's going to pick up at the very same spot where I left off when I was playing it at home last night. Check it out.
I always liked Bumblebee.
Oh, he's dead.
It's awesome.
Okay, cool. So you just saw how easy it was for Matt to play a movie from his collection on my TV. No messy authentication or configuration needed. It just works. And remember, what's really cool here is that Matt is controlling what's happening from his Android tablet, but the movie is coming directly from the cloud. Now, it's always fun to watch YouTube videos with friends, and Nexus Q works great with YouTube. Just like with music, you and your friends can play your favorite YouTube videos right on Nexus Q. And again, the content comes from the cloud. So Randall's going to go into the YouTube app and search for Android in Space. Some of the guys on our team worked with a student who had a great idea to send an Android figurine into space. So let's take a look at that. So that's really cool. But now let's take a look at another video. Matt, what would you like to see?
There's this cool video of these guys beatboxing on a Google Plus Hangout on their Galaxy Nexuses. Let's play that.
Cool. Yeah.
Check this out.
So, as you can see, Matt was able to just take over the TV, straight from YouTube. No more passing around a keyboard or laptop. Everyone is in control. So that's Nexus Q. Amazing hardware with an integrated app. It streams music, movies, and TV from Google Play, as well as YouTube. And what's really cool is that it's the world's first ever social streaming device. Nexus Q will sell for $299. It'll be available in the US to start, and you'll be able to purchase it right from Google Play. You can place a pre-order starting today, and we'll begin shipping orders in July. Thanks, everyone. And here's Hugo to wrap things up.
Thanks, guys. That was pretty awesome. Well, we hope you guys liked what you saw here today. 400 million Android devices, Jelly Bean, Google Play, Nexus 7, Nexus Q. Now, the Android ecosystem would be nothing without our developer community. So I wanted to thank you guys for your incredible support. Thank you. We hope you enjoy the 26 dedicated Android sessions, plus all the sandboxes that we put together for you here at Google I/O. There's a lot to see, and look forward to seeing you at the party tonight. Thank you.